Welcome to our debate about this time about the Balkans and Austrian NATO accession, and especially about the Southeastern European history of the last 30 years, and also to call not to invite the Nobel Prize laureate Peter Handke to any public events in Austria and in the European Union or in any NATO country. I have seen now that he is still invited to some media events, and it's upcoming now, the 10th of October, the sad anniversary of this tragic failure of the Nobel Prize Commission to give him this Nobel Prize for his literature. You know, he might be an interesting offer, but somebody who has done this kind of activities like he has done, going to Milosevic's funeral, going to Kosovo during the apartheid and defending Serb nationalism, and worst of all, obviously, he was denying the genocide in against the Bosnian Serbs. And there was so many protests of the family members of the victims of the Serb aggression in Bosnia during his after his awarding of his this Nobel Prize to him. You know, then the Austrians still received him, even State President of Austria, Van der Bellen, you know, the light of modern Austria has unfortunately shown solidarity with him, and there was the feeling in the Austrian media that he is unfair attacked because it's something he felt personally after he has written all these books, but you know, that was just in the 90s, you know. And so it's really very bad what we did after this Nobel Prize laureate. You know, now he has the prize and may he live in retirement and fine, but he shouldn't be invited, and certainly not where any kind of high public officials are there, because it's disgraceful what he has done during the 90s, and he has not regretted anything up to now. And I want to explain a little bit why this happens, because many of my friends in Southeastern Europe, they ask me what is exactly going on with this guy. And you know, the problem is, he is himself also in a certain way a victim, because he is a leading, in his world, philosopher of the Austrian left, and he is really a product of all this talk, you know, about anti-Americanism, about anti-imperialism, America in that sense as the imperial power. He is the really classical product of this kind of a myth of Austria as the neutral bridge, an alternative world, a third way is possible, Tito and the Bloc Free as a role model for Austria, and so on and so on. This is exactly the product. He's just the most extreme guy who then identified Yugoslavia under Milosevic as a kind of victim of American colonialism. And then he even took into account the mass killings of the Serbs. He looked away. He even visited Srebrenica, and he was in many of these Bosnian places of atrocities. You know, it's just a kind of a total extreme form of this Austrian anti-Americanism, which I criticize so much. And this Austrian left-wing anti-Americanism, unfortunately, is very strong. It's not a coincidence that Van der Bellen, who was, of course, from the Green Party, but is a leading left-wing thinker like Fischer, you know, he has actually welcomed him in that reason, because he is such a prominent Austrian representative of the Austrian left-wing movement, and that's where it's coming from. And in a way, it's just for his world, it's totally logic to speak at the funeral of Milosevic, because Milosevic was bombed by the Americans, so he must be a good guy. You know, it's very sad. It's hard to understand for anybody of the free world, this philosophy, but it's very common, and it's one of the reasons why Austria still is not in NATO. Because the Christian Democrats, they were ready in the 90s to look for NATO membership. Yeah, but obviously this kind of anti-American consensus, and especially then connected to the Bosnian wars, you know, and this kind of thinking, then Kosovo liberation was not so much perceived as liberation by many in Austria, but as an intervention, American war, we don't want to be part of it, and so on. And then, of course, the Iraq intervention. And so in the mind of all this kind of left-wing bubble, it was all totally logical. They are the classical conspiracy theorists. And this is all created, of course, you know, because they have also interpreted the World War II from the beginning totally wrong. You know, they have seen it as the victory of Stalin. Yeah? They have not seen it as the victory of the free world because they lived in Vienna. Vienna was liberated by the Soviets. They were thankful for the Soviets, and that was it, basically. And starting from that kind of narrative, which then was then in Austria very well kept, and then they have seen the whole world in this kind of Stalinistic mindset. Yeah? Of course, they are now not for Stalin anymore. But, you know, this anti-Americanism is still very strong and powerful. And that's the reason, in the basic fundamental concept on which he was thinking. And then, you know, the events of the 90s were confirming his already existing beliefs. And then he went totally rogue and totally berserk. I mean, you have to imagine an Austrian author and prominent personality speaking at the funeral of Slobodan Milosevic, yeah? And not being above himself to be used by a Serb nationalist extremist in Kosovo, in Bosnia, to be the good guy for them. They will now erect a monument, I have seen, in Republika Srpska, Mr. Dodik, exactly looking for everything provocative. And being happy to find he's supposedly now a friend of the American president or whatever. You know, that's a bit of another issue. Anyhow, let's not go that. I will speak about it in a bit later. But please don't invite him. It's utterly wrong and it's absolutely a failure. I want to speak now this, you know, because in Austria, to my best knowledge, it was never really explained the narrative of European liberation from the American perspective. Yeah? I mean, you know, of course they know that there was D-Day and all these things, but the liberation was attributed to the Soviet Union from the start. All these kind of personalities which have built up Western Europe and free Europe, especially then, you know, in the construction of the post-war reconstruction. You know, there is a bit of knowledge about Churchill and Marshall, and but, you know, when it goes a bit deeper, Monet, yes, there is an effort to get him right now. But Mises, Truman, Acheson, yeah, you know, Eisenhower, yeah, he was president of America. You know, the knowledge of these 10 very decisive personalities in Austria, which was always under this kind of neutral, kind of be careful, the Russian ambassador could be critical to any kind of historic narrative. It is simply never has been told, yeah, that freedom of Western Europe is related to American power and to American values. And to Americans have helped to build NATO and, of course, the European Union as well. And that there is basically no difference in values and ideas between the European Union and NATO. You know, it's 93% of the same citizens in Europe. You know, this is some kind of artificial differences. Yeah, but they were then, you know, always great, you know, we are neutral, you know, we have to take the bridge to Russia, and so on and so on. And then such tragic extremists like Mr. Handke come as a result of that. It's the original European sin, anti-Americanism. It's very strong, you know, there are different roots and different kind of origins of this anti-Americanism. You know, in the Western powers, like in France and England, it's maybe more jealousy of imperial status. And that's a bit less in Germany and Austria, but there's also enough of it. But you see also what really is a big difference is if the Americans stayed longer and made more effort for re-education after World War II, like in Western Germany, and then much less in Austria, and none in Eastern Germany, you see the results in election and in attitudes and in everything still today, and something we should really start to get active to tell and explain the correct narrative of freedom, the values, and the Atlantic Charter, and all these things. I think in Austria about 10 people know what the Atlantic Charter is. Okay, but everybody knows what Yugoslavia is, and that's of course a big thing. We have also a lot of new people from Yugoslavia. They are all, you know, they have taken some beliefs from Yugoslavia out of their childhood or from the childhood of their parents. So there is a lot of Yugo nostalgia here in Austria, and you know the myth that this was something good, you know, you know that there was something positive about Yugoslavia, and then of course this fits in this narrative, you know, where then ultimately Handke is a product. Yeah, Oh, yes, we had healthcare for all. We had such a good system. We had jobs for everybody. Yes, because the Americans massively financed Yugoslavia because they didn't want it to join the Warsaw Pact. So there was some central money. But it was never really working, and it was an authoritarian socialist state. Yeah? And it was very oppressive. It killed its opposition people on the streets of Munich and everywhere in Europe. Yeah? It was a terrible dictatorship. Yeah? There was nothing good in Yugoslavia. And we have to explain that. It must be really understood. Yeah? Because on that myth, Yugoslavia was good. There was some Western intrigue to destroy the Americans again. Yeah, the CIA. Yeah, sure. And then you end up in all this mess where then some, you know, sad, confused guys out of this kind of bubble and then go to speak at Milosevic's funeral. I mean, I really feel in a way, of course, you know, I don't feel any pity with him because he is really a genocide denier. He should be punished like anybody who is denying the genocide, the Holocaust, the Holodomor, you know, all this kind of tragic and terrible crimes, he should be punished. But, you know, he is a product of this kind of thinking, and he probably, you know, when he listened to that video, he would not understand anything. Anyhow, it's a tragedy. What we really need to do is to make sure that Austria supports Kosovo to be a UN member, and when we have the Day of Peace, that Austria really reiterates this demand towards Russia and China, and be, you know, living up on the European values. I mean, that's what we want. That's why we have recognized. Where's the tweet of Mr. Sebastian to go and say, hello, we want the UN to accept Kosovo? I didn't see it. So, Vienna should also have a street for Ibrahim Rugova, and that's very important. He's the hero of the peaceful freedom struggle of the Republic of Kosovo. And he should definitely have a street in Vienna to honor him. He has a highway already in Kosovo, and this is something very good. He got the Sakharov Prize of the European Parliament. He should have a street in Vienna. And the same should be for Alija Izetbegovic, the hero of the liberation struggle from Bosnia. And he also should have a square named after him in beautiful Vienna. Because we need this to honor these two personalities, but also for a debate to understand why NATO has liberated these two countries, why this was good, why Austrian kind of left and right-wing nationalism and anti-Americanism is wrong. We need to really start this debate, and such naming controversies will be very, very good to explain this clearer to the Austrian public. And destroys some of the neutrality myths which unfortunately we have. I want to explain how it really was, you know, in the year 91. Yeah? You know, the Slovenians wanted to be free. They always wanted to be free. They never wanted to be in Yugoslavia from the first place. Yeah? They only wanted to be safe from an Italian attack after the end of World War I. Yeah? The Italians threatened to conquer them. And then they said, okay, the Serb were the only army left after the defeat of Austria-Hungary, and so then they formed up. But really, they never wanted. In the year 1990, when there was the end of communism, they saw the opportunity for independence, and they wanted to have that. And Milosevic sent the army. Before, by the way, he printed so much money and took so much loan from the Republic of Serbia, from the federal authority, that anyhow a kind of union was fiscally completely impossible. But then also he sent the tanks, and then the Slovenians decided to run away. Also the Croatians. And it was not a fantastic welcome by the European Union, by the way. It was a much smaller European Union, only of 12 states back then. But, you know, the Brioni Agreement was basically to put a hold, a freeze on Slovenian-Croatian independence in order to appease the Serbs and find some compromise, whatever the compromise can be with independence. It's always, for me, very interesting, either you are independent or not. What exactly can be the compromise? But the appeasement really was used from the first day towards Milosevic, and he understood that there is weakness in Europe. America was on this transition time from Bush to Clinton, and it was really then his opportunity to start a full-scale war. He started in Vukovar against Croatia, put the army towards Zagreb, and tried to conquer whatever he thought could be his from Croatia, and from Bosnia. You know, and then also it's very important, there was then the Macedonian independence that was recognized later, but there was at least no war in Macedonia. But Kosovo also declared the first republic, the independence in 91 on the 22nd of September. But the Europeans said, okay, Kosovo, we don't know exactly where it is on the map. Yeah? And, you know, the whole narrative of Yugoslavia. And then this was rejected by the Western powers. And the Kosovars were, of course, too weak, not like the Croatians. They were too weak to really have no supplies and no army. And, you know, they were very careful because they exactly knew what the capacities of the Yugoslav People's Army will be. And they have seen also what then later happened, of course, in Bosnia. Because there the full brunt of the Yugoslavian army was taken against their own population. You see here the burning of Sarajevo municipality building, the most famous building of Sarajevo. You see also then this 3-year-long siege of Sarajevo, where there was terrible atrocities committed against the population, and was really a very terrible action of the Yugoslavian army against its own population. Then gradually, you know, first came this internal conflict, obviously, between the Croatians, and they had also a very dubious role, but then the Americans brokered a peace between the Croatians and the Bosnian Muslim forces. And then came the start of the year 95, when gradually, you know, the French president was then Chirac. He was much more pro-American and less pro-Serb nationalist, like his predecessor Mitterrand. And so there was the opportunity for Western joint action, and gradually it came. But obviously, you know, there was much more kind of a fight about the last remaining territories. And, you know, then came, of course, the big action. I have not exactly now in the right order this one, because first came the genocide against the Bosnian Serbs, you know, in July 95, yeah? Because they already had this this big understanding that NATO will now intervene. And then they thought they can use the time to create as many dead people as possible in order to ethnically liberate the eastern Bosnia. That was the strategy. It was not like it was a real strategy. That's why it's also a genocide. It was a state planned, you know, by military forces, organized mass killing. I mean, if that's not a genocide, I really don't know. And then this belongs to the second one. And then, you know, with that being more understood by even Clinton, who was very reluctant to intervene, then of course came the moment where then the rollback started. Yeah. And then American power and NATO power, French power, they had then started first the Croatian recovery operation. It's called Operation Storm. And then came also the joint military action on the 13th of August, the Liberation Day. It was not taking very long to destroy the main operational bases of the Bosnian Serbs. And then there was the question if this must be extended also to Serbia. And then this led to the Dayton Peace Accord, which was very positive, actually, given the military situation at that moment. It was very positive for the Bosnian Serbs, because they still got half of the country, 49%. There's a great video on that one from BBC on Dayton Peace. Please watch it. But, you know, that was very, very much contrary to the military situation, because they would have maybe... there's a lot of Bosnians out there who say if there would have been no stop of the fighting from the side of the Americans, then basically there would have been a complete victory of the Bosnian Muslims and the Croatian forces at that moment. Yeah? So they were very lucky in that sense. And they can be really, they should behave a bit different now to NATO membership, yeah? Because they committed a lot of atrocities. So, and then let's remember, you know what happened? And then there was a relatively kind of, whatever kind of a freeze in the Balkans. But gradually, you know, after 95 and the Dayton Agreement, 96, 97, 97 started already Kosovo liberation struggle, and because the repression in Kosovo started to get really very hard, the crackdowns. And that was the time actually when Handke then visited Pristina. And it was terrible situations in this apartheid years in Kosovo. It was really, really a terrible regime. Now the whole world is so united to criticize apartheid regime. But this was even worse. You know, there was a kind of total ethnic discrimination and exclusion from the institutions. People were going in barracks in school, whenever. But they were beaten up by the police when they saw them with Albanian school books. Children were beaten up. And so on. And obviously a lot of people were killed. And the most famous, obviously, is then in the year, on the 5th of March of 98, when the Serbian, it's always called police, but in fact, these are like paramilitary forces, or kind of anti-terror units, who went on a rampage and they killed this whole family. You know, they killed them. This is the burial site. I've been there myself personally. I mean, Handke should have gone to that place, yeah? Anyhow. So then came the 15th January 99, and much more atrocities in between, but there were so many massacres, but this is then the most famous one, where also the Ambassador Walker came to visit, and then it was basically the moment where then the big campaign started to get a million Albanians out of Kosovo, and Milosevic had to be stopped, and there was the Kosovo intervention, the liberation. And, you know, it was really the right thing to do. It was really stopping a mass ethnic violence and suppression. And, you know, that was really something we can be very proud about, yeah? And I'm very proud about it, and I'm very happy. Thank you, USA and NATO, for having liberated Kosovo. And this was really the right moral thing to do. War can also be justified if it's morally right to liberate people. The same like the Second World War, the intervention of the Americans in World War II was liberated to liberate Austria from the Nazis. Thank you very much, USA, for liberating us from the Nazis, for keeping us safe from the communists, and also for liberating Europe from dictatorships like Milosevic. Good, that was Balkan Liberation Day on the 11th of June. And, you know, that was really very good. It was the liberation day not only for Kosovo, but also, of course, for Montenegro. And it led also to the liberation of Serbia. The 5th of October 2000 could not be possible without the victory of NATO and the intervention. Obviously, you know, it's also myself, you know, my grandparents' house in Vienna was also destroyed by American bombs in World War II, you know. It was close to the southern train station. You can always see then, oh, the Americans destroyed my house. But you can also see it like this. The American liberated the whole Austria, which was in part with Germany, you know, from a terrible dictatorship, which did so many atrocities. Yeah. So there is a lot of Serb youth who believe this lie that the Serbians bombed us and that was unfair. No, your regime committed terrible atrocities, so the bombing were good because you didn't have to live under Milosevic. This is the way to see it, yeah? And this is the fact. And, you know, everything else is a wholly nationalistic socialist lie. The Montenegrins ran away and they introduced the German mark and they later introduced the euro, later became independent in 2006 under a lot of appeasement pressure of the European Union to even have 55 support and so on and so on. But they managed to get free. And also, Serbia became a free country on the 5th of October. There was this pro-European revolution. I really wonder if Vucic will make it a big holiday this year after 20 years of freedom and European Serbia. And you know, it was really one of the transformative moments of Europe, and it should be a European-wide holiday, absolutely, the Freedom Day. Unfortunately, not everybody saw it like that. 3 years later, they killed the hero of European Serbia. I'm honored to have met him twice and shaked his hand on meetings as a student leader and in Vienna. But, you know, he was a real hero. I mean, he was the man who was transforming a terrible dictatorship into a European democracy. And he was killed on the 12th of March 2003. They shot him in front of his office, yeah, in the middle of Belgrade. God bless him. So, and one of the reasons, obviously, because he hinted that he was ready for accepting the facts, you know, the Kosovo independence, yeah? That was definitely one of the reasons, yeah, why he was shot, yeah? And then later it came anyhow. And this is also a national, a European holiday, absolutely, in my view, the 17th of February of 2008, when Kosovo declared it as an independence. And then instead of one terrible dictatorship of socialist origin, we had exactly 3, 5, 7 new countries, all of them free, people living much better, and really on the way to prosperity, as I have done in other economic presentations. But this is the better setup for this region, and it was actually always the better setup. I want to just one moment, because I'm aware that the situation is not perfect in the Balkans. There's many other conflicts and inherited issues from the past between Greek and Albania. Please, the EU should intervene and help. There's many other issues between Macedonia and Greece. It's not only Kosovo and Serbia, and we all have to work hard to do better, because this is the one big issue which kept the European politics from the Vienna Congress to the First World War, and of course then on and on and on. For 200 years we're trying to settle the situation of political economic future of what you can call the European Turkey, or the Macedonian question, or the Great Eastern question. And you know, there were so many wars and so complicated. Now we are close to settling it in a very good European and Western manner, and that's very good, and we should really focus on that, because that's a 200-year-long crisis, and then a crisis with Turkey, a crisis with Russia, and it's very important to remember how it all was with the First and Second Balkan Wars, how this was complicated, and it was ultimately leading also to World War I. It was obviously Austria very much responsibility. But it was an Austrian-Russian war, ultimately, about the domination of the European Turkey. The Straits played a major role, and also in the role of Austrian ambitions against Serbia, and so on and so on. So a lot of responsibility in Austria and Russia for that. And Austria, as a EU member country, should really understand that, regret that more. We even attacked, but that's 110 years ago, but it was three failed Austrian attacks on Serbia. I mean, this kind of behavior of Austria, totally disaster. Anyhow, now what is really important is that Austria, Kosovo, Bosnia and Serbia are all in NATO. You know, it's not only my middle campaign, it's not only about Austria and Kosovo in NATO, but it must be Bosnia, but it must be Serbia. All countries united and secure, in partnership, in alliance with America. Then there will be peace in Europe for long term, hopefully forever. But this is very important. And let's remind, this is the first boat, the Austrian boat, which has bombarded Belgrade in 1940. Let's not forget, you know, all the chaos on the Balkan has led to the First World War and to all the disasters afterwards, which were connected to World War I and the tragedies of the 20th century. So now it's time for peace, and Serbia, please, Bosnia, please, Kosovo, Austria, in all Central Europe, in NATO. So when it comes to the Yugoslavia, I want to remind that the idea that Yugoslavia was something great, not even 10 years it stayed some kind of not really working democracy. After 10 years it became already an authoritarian monarchy, a dictatorship by the king. Why? Because the different ethnic groups really didn't want to live together, and they were ready to shoot each other in the parliament of Yugoslavia. I mean, this was a very tragic incident on the 20th of June in 1928. It was already, you know, shooting between the parliamentarians in the parliament. Let's conclude, you know, Yugoslavia, I call it the Goli Otok Day. That's a small island which was a prison island of Yugoslavia then after the Second World War. And it is a lot of crimes committed. Yeah? Yugoslavia was nothing good. Yugoslavia was a socialist dictatorship. Yeah? It was maybe with an open door policy. You could run away to Germany after 68 and to Austria. And very good, you know, at least some could escape. Yeah? But, you know, that and some people, if you know, were not politically and just a farmer or just, you know, a normal employee of some state company, you could live maybe quite good, yeah, some years ago on the subsidies of the Americans and the Germans, yeah. Better maybe than in the Soviet Union or in Romania, Bulgaria or in Albania for sure, yeah. But, you know, it was still a disaster. and it ended in disaster. Anyhow, so my final few slides, some might have seen them already. I very much support the peace agreement between Serbia and Kosovo. I call it a peace agreement because economic normalization is a term necessary because Serbia was not really ready for peace, and that's very regrettable, but I call it peace agreement, and it was a very good step. Israel recognized, so that is really good. We need more of that, and we need more progress. But let's not forget, Mr. Vucic was the propaganda minister of Milosevic still, and when he came in power, in full power in 2014, he really started very hard hitting on Kosovo. 15 de-recognitions he achieved, yeah, and only 5 we have recognized in the meantime. So he is really competent, yeah, capable, very vicious actor against peace in the Balkans. That's it. If he is now ready for peace, really under American pressure, we will see. If he is really a good actor, recognize Kosovo, allow in some international organization, use the term republic on Twitter for Kosovo, or make real progress. Yeah? But as long as this hole is running and the status is open, we will discuss later about the status of Kosovo, meaning there is no compromise possible on the status of sovereignty. Either you are a sovereign nation or not. And the only status of sovereignty can be by pooling it in NATO and in the EU. EU is a supranational organization, both should join. NATO is a defense alliance, both should join. But as an independent state, and that's peace in the Balkans, nothing else. I call again on all our experts from Spain, Slovakia, Cyprus, and Romania and Greece. You know, they are all great Balkan experts. They all know it much better than me from Austria, absolutely. And they know exactly how to get money, but not to do anything when we call them to recognize. But they call for billions. I have this other slide with Schur, with this massive transfer as well. And you know that I'm against massive transfer to countries who are not in compliance with our common foreign policy. I call for a peace summit in Brussels now. Kosovo, Serbia and Bosnia should be invited by von der Leyen and Stoltenberg together, all the three, to Brussels, sit together and then enforce peace between them by threat of not paying anything anymore. Then they will be very soon bankrupt. There will be no China to save Serbia. There will be no Russia to save Serbia as long as it is behaving like this. We can try it 2 years, then there will be a state bankruptcy and we will see the consequences. So I call for a peace summit, but under the threat of stopping EU transfers. So, but let's not get too negative. You know, we can also repeat it like with Kosovo and Serbia, now with Kosovo and Bosnia. Let's make a peace summit between the two, maybe also in the White House, an invitation of the US president, if that works very fine. Bosnia can also move the embassy to Jerusalem, and why not? Yeah, this is for recognition of Kosovo. That's very good. Ultimately, there can be 6 countries, which are anyhow all of them dependent on EU subsidies, but not so well treated by the EU, because the EU is rejecting their EU future quite clearly on the very long term. Emmanuel Macron talked about 2035 for the first ones, and then we are talking about this one, whatever, 15 years later, so we are really on the very much on the delaying line here for them. So why not to have a united European house of all these 6 countries? They are pro-European, pro-American, pro-Israeli. They should sit together in one house, the ambassadors, next to the beautiful center of Jerusalem, maybe also close to Yad Vashem, and think about the past and the crimes and all the things that happened between them, and which were also, some of them might be perpetrators and victims, and some of them should also be, and all 6 of them should be united in EU and in NATO, and it's very good to be united already in Jerusalem, in a European house. And that would be my proposal. I call also for Kosovo and Ukraine peace summit. Why not invite them to the White House together and make a similar show event? It was a lot of show, but it was also some substance. It was concrete results, and I'm actually very grateful for the president. This was one of his, you know, it was very much criticized by a lot of the analysts, but ultimately Israel has recognized Kosovo, and that's only what matters for me. And you know, it was also some other content, yeah, about economic infrastructure. Good, it was progress. So let's do the same for Ukraine and Kosovo in the White House, and that would be something America can do. Promise the non-alliance status to Ukraine, or invite them to the Adriatic process of the Defense Department. There's a lot of good things Trump can do for Ukraine, and recognize Kosovo, and so Kosovo will be also very much benefiting from another recognition. Trump can pose as peacemaker, and he is actually making peace, so that's good. EU obviously can also do wonderful things now with its instruments, because we have the Schengen instrument. We can allow the Belarusians and people from Kosovo, Armenia and Azerbaijan to also, like everybody else in Europe, outside of Turkey and Russia, and I'm against giving that to Turkey and Russia. But on these four countries, you know, it's not so many people anymore. It's 25 million Europeans who are not into this Schengen free visa. And it would make a lot of sense, because otherwise the people are trapped at Lukashenko's kind of prison, and they cannot escape because we don't allow them visa. That's totally wrong. And also Armenia and Azerbaijan would be maybe a good sign for peace if we allow that and support that, and we can reintroduce it if they start fighting again. And for Kosovo, it's also very clear that it's time for visa liberalization. Again, in summing up, I say what we need to do is to euroize the whole of Eastern Europe, and that is very important. Kosovo and Montenegro have it already. Serbia, as part of the peace agreement, absolutely adopt the euro as well. So then it basically you're also locked in the European currency system, and that's very good against corruption. It's very good for investment, and it's very good for the savers and consumers. And please do that very fast. And here comes obviously, you know, the Berlin process. We need to fast track now for all NATO allies in the Balkans. First, you know, EU members shall be the countries who are already in NATO. That's Albania, that's Montenegro, North Macedonia. That's very logical. They can be in this mandate in the EU. There's no problem if they adopt the euro as well in the case of North Macedonia and Albania. So good. Then my last one, I always make this a little bit also to explain what is the Adriatic Charter. It's not my invitation for any yacht. I don't have any. But it's the enlargement process of the Defense Ministry of the US to prepare countries towards NATO membership. And they have already successfully managed Croatia, Montenegro, Albania, North Macedonia, four success stories. And it's also Bosnia and Kosovo in there. Also Serbia is there. So let's get also Ukraine, Georgia, Moldova into this process, because it's open. It works very well. And also the six neutrals of EU for Malta, Cyprus, and also Sweden and Finland and Ireland and Austria should join. And so it would be very good to have this enlargement process. And I close on a very optimistic slide. You know, peace and progress is possible. Europe has also done, together with the Americans, very good success in the Prespa peace in Macedonia, a historic breakthrough of one of the big issues. And this was a major achievement. So I think, you know, with some kind of goodwill on both sides, now to have a peace between Kosovo and Bosnia, Kosovo and Ukraine, to get these two relations in target. That would send also a wonderful message to the Bosnian population that they can join NATO, they can join EU then, get the candidate status. Also then very good two new recognitions from Bosnia and from Ukraine, and also to clear the Ukraine path towards NATO, to have the Adriatic Charter opened for these countries from the Black Sea area as well, and also for the neutrals, and to have really good success in this mandate. I think it's very possible, and this is very good. And Mr. Handke, you will not win. You know, your kind of anti-Americanism and left-wing socialist kind of philosophy is on the losing stream. You can have the Nobel Prize and be in retirement. It's free society, nothing bad to you, but don't go on public meetings, please. Yeah. Don't spread your lies. Don't spread your hatred. Yeah? Don't spread your genocidal denial philosophy in the public, in the media. That is utterly wrong. And I call on all who want to discuss with him, don't go to these events. Yeah? Boycott it. Don't be seen on pictures with him in the public. This is not a good man to be on a picture with. You shouldn't be. Yeah? It's immoral positions which he had. a lot of people are hurt by his Nobel Prize winning, and we should respect the victims of Srebrenica. And I call on all authorities and all personalities who think it's nice to have a picture with a Nobel Prize winner. No, it's not. It's evil. It's wrong. Don't do it. Don't go. Don't discuss. Don't invite Mr. Peter Handke. Thanks a lot.